Before we look at different ways to represent or model real-world information in our programs, it is important to understand a bit about how they work under the hood. By that, I mean the different ways they are represented and accessed in memory space. If anything in this lesson does not make immediate sense in theory, do not feel as though it will stop you from completing the practical parts of this course. Studying theory is one way to learn, but for many of us, myself included, writing the code itself is a better teacher. If you have ever studied algebra, then you should be familiar with symbols such as x, which represent some value. This is of course called a variable in algebra, and usually they represent some kind of number. Thankfully, in most programming languages, we have a lot more flexibility over what a variable represents. However, computers do not like surprises, so we must tell them ahead of time about what kind or type which a given variable will be. There are many different types of variables, but they can be categorized broadly into one of two types. For my ESL friends, yes, the words kind, category, and type can be used interchangeably, so I am basically talking about two types of types. Welcome to the field of type theory. At the lowest level, computers work with machine code, which we can think of as zeros and ones or binary language. Through clever manipulation of binary mathematics, we can represent things like negative numbers or floating point decimals using such mathematics. We can also use a technique called encoding, where we associate some particular character with a series or string of binary values. My point is that by using very basic things like 0 and 1, we can build and represent more complicated things. Thankfully, in Java and most other high-level languages, we do not need to work exclusively in binary. Java provides us with 8 different fundamental or basic types, which are known as primitive types. Those types can represent integers of varying sizes, floating point or decimal numbers, a single 16-bit Unicode character, or a Boolean, which represents either true or false. Primitive types always start with a lowercase character, and this is important as the compiler will not treat them the same way if you use an uppercase first letter. It is also important to remember that these primitives take up varying amounts of memory space. Normally this difference is negligible, but if you would like to learn when it is not, then you will want to study a topic called asymptotic runtime and space complexity. This is a topic in software engineering and is outside the scope of this introductory software development course. In simple terms though, if you are dealing with enormous quantities of data, you need to be concerned about using the smallest and most efficient types for the job. Another kind of variable in Java is called a reference type variable. This particular name, reference, has been the source of confusion and many arguments for students of programming for over 20 years. I will address this confusion more in the next part of this course when we talk about functions and logic. The purpose of these reference types is when we want a variable which represents something not suitably represented with a primitive. That is a vague answer, but do not worry, we will be looking at many of these situations in detail soon. Two important differences between reference and primitive types are that reference types always start with a capital letter, or at least they should, and, unlike primitives, they store memory addresses instead of values. Before we move on, it is very useful that you understand how primitive and reference type variables work in memory space. Explaining this verbally is difficult, so I will use a simple visual analogy side by side with a tool that allows us to step through a program incrementally to see what the states of these variables are in memory space. Before I proceed, while I normally stick to practical code examples, this one is not useful for anything except to demonstrate variables in memory space. This first line creates a variable called firstValue, which is of type int. Since this type starts with a lowercase, it is a, take a guess, primitive type. This second line creates another variable called secondValue, which is of type integer. Since it starts with an uppercase, we know it is a, this one should be easy, reference type. This third line, age3, creates another integer reference variable, but something strange is going on, which we will talk about in a moment. This fourth line creates a char variable, short for character, which is also a primitive. I will now show you what is happening line by line in this program using a debugging tool called a stepper. It allows us to step through our code on a line-by-line basis. It also allows us to see what the virtual memory space of a program looks like as we step through it. Let us execute this first line. Our memory space is now populated with a variable called firstValue, and the value which it contains is a number, 26. Let us execute the next line of code. As you can see, variable secondValue just popped up in memory, but there is something different going on here. Instead of storing a number, we see a type and an address in virtual memory. If we go to that address, we would find the value 1, but the key point is that reference type variables store an address to a location in memory. After executing line 3, we see that a variable called thirdValue does exist, but the value it stores is null. Null is essentially a way of saying that this reference variable does not reference anywhere in memory. If we tried to access this variable later on, the program would crash with a null pointer exception, since it is like asking a computer to go to a place in memory that does not exist. Computers don't like that. Let's execute our last line of code to see what a char primitive looks like. Now, as you can see, our debugging tool is doing some extra work here and actually showing the capital A, but what is really stored here is the number 65. What does 65 mean? Well, if you look up a list of Unicode characters, you would find that the code for the capital A is in fact 65. I cannot count the number of times in my career when something did not make sense to me when explained verbally, but made perfect sense when I either looked at what was going on in the memory space, source code, or even generated bytecode. Keep that in mind and do not be afraid to invest the time in learning tools like the debugger.